Hello everyone. So today in this topic, in this lesson, we will be looking at the non-tariff trade barriers. All right. So we will be looking at various sorts of non-tariff trade barriers. I hope all of you are clear regarding tariff and non-tariff trade barriers. Non-tariff trade barriers and the new protectionism. So the new protectionism implies the new sort of, you know, protectionism attitude, which is, you know, the developing countries are developing because they want to boost their domestic growth. So let us see what sorts of non-tariff trade barriers are there. So first we have import quotas, then voluntary export restraints, technical administrative measures. They are also known as phytosanitary and sanitary measures. Then we have international cartels, dumping, and then export subsidies. We will be covering all of these topics in a detailed manner so that you can have a conceptual clarity. So let's start. Import quotas. So from the word itself, we can get to know what is a quota. Quota is a restriction. In the sense, it tells us the maximum limit or the minimum limit. All right, so quota is direct quantitative restrictions. So in the international trade, countries come up with import quota. So it is a direct quantitative restrictions on the traded commodity. So under import quota, a country cannot import or export a particular product beyond that particular limit. For instance, let us take an example of India, getting ventilators. So now India wants 1 lakh ventilators and now they want to import 1 lakh ventilator. But the government has said that a country cannot import more than 50,000 ventilator from the United States of America. So there is a quantitative restrictions of 50,000 in the import of the ventilators. So the government, basically they will allow for imports of only 50,000 ventilators. The rest 50,000 ventilators will be produced domestically. So this will boost the domestic industry's growth. All right. See, it is used to protect the nascent industries. Now, nascent industries are those industries which are at the beginner's level. Okay. So these industries are at the basic, are at the base. So they are yet not developed at the extent that they can, you know, cope up with the foreign competition. So import quota is very essential to boost the domestic growth. All right. And this also boosts the economic growth. So it promotes more and more inclusive sort of growth. Now in the Uruguay round, the World Trade Organization has banned this sort of quantitative restriction. Next is voluntarily export restraints. So what is a VER? VER. So under a VER, what happens is the threat is given. All right. So here the importing country gives a threat. All right. Gives the threat, or you can say that it actually urges the exporting nation to restrict the exports of a particular commodity. So the country will tell other country that please limit the exports of so and so product to our country, and if you are not complying with our decision, then we will impose tariff on you, we will impose higher tariff, and we will come up with other barriers of trade. All right, if you are not complying with our decision. So VER, this was also prohibited under the Uruguay round. Now, think for a second, is there any loophole under voluntarily export restraints? So yes, most of you are right. The loophole is that whenever VER is given, so suppose if VER is given for a particular country, say United States of America, so now if that USA is not giving that particular commodity to India beyond a certain limit, then if the government thinks that that particular good can be produced in the domestic economy, in case if it is not getting produced, there are other avenues as well. So if we cannot get supply from the USA because VER is in place, we can get supply of that particular product from any other country on those countries where VER has not been imposed. So in such cases, VER fails, because this VER will only be successful if you are imposing this VER on all the member countries of WTO. So now let us look at technical and administrative regulations. In the technical and administrative regulations, we have sanitary and phytosanitary measures. So the sanitary and phytosanitary measures deals with plant, animal, and human life. So whenever trade takes place in those products, which humans directly consume, or when trade takes place between in the plant and animal life, then these measures comes into picture. In the picture, so in the picture you can see that a scientist is collecting the fruits and vegetables in order to test whether it is good, whether it is safe for human consumption or not. Will it pose any threat or not? So these are the most stringent measures. All right. Now there are number of examples when these measures were imposed on number of countries. For instance, few years back, European Union has imposed ban on the fish imports from Bangladesh because they found that that the fishes were not safe for human consumption. After certain years, the ban was revoked. All right. So this is imposed. So this is the most stringent measures. All right. Then we have labeling requirement and packaging. Now in labeling requirement and packaging, what you do is you come up with a set of guidelines that if you want to import a particular food item in when you want to import or export a particular food item, the packaging should be in such a manner, the standard packaging should be of so and so units. All right, there is a certain criteria which you give out. You give out a layout. Then with respect to labeling, you usually say that you want the manufacturing details where this product has been manufactured in all the countries, mention the countries where it has been manufactured, or the nutritional details, etc. All right, then you have export and import permits. So here export and import permits implies you are giving out license to certain exporters and importers to trade in that specific commodity. All right, so the particular commodity can be traded by the exporters and importers who have that permit or license. All right. International cartel implies when group of seller comes together at the international level. So the product is sold at the international level. They come together, they form a union and try to restrict the supply of that good so that they can get higher price. They can sell the product at higher price and thus they can get higher profits. So there is an issue with the international cartel because there are cases when it fails. So it can fail when either of the member country doesn't comply with the decision. For instance, the best example will be the OPEC, the oil producing exporting country. So their decision on crude oil is something which is not every member country is following. So because of that, if OPEC as a whole decides that we will limit the supply, but if few of the member countries says that no, we won't comply with your decision, in such a scenario, the international cartel fail. Now, next is export subsidies. Let us understand this with the help of a picture example, basically. So here we have two countries, country A and country B. So in the country A, the government is giving farmer various sorts of subsidies. Say the government is giving free electricity, free water, free seeds and cheap machinery. So the input cost of the banana for the farmer will be very, very less. All right. In the country B, the government is giving no subsidies to the farmer. So the price of banana in the country B will be expensive, will be higher, it will be costly. So the bananas of country A, which are cheaper, will be sold in country B. Now the country B banana will not be purchased. No one will purchase the banana of country B because their bananas will be expensive. Whereas the banana which country A is giving are cheap. So this is leading to increase in the exports of country A. All right. So now there are different sorts of subsidies. So I hope you are clear about the basic of the export subsidies. So yes, the aim of export subsidies is that you have to increase your export share in the international market. So country wants to increase its export share. This export subsidies boost the exports. It also stimulate the domestic growth. Now, there are various ways through which export subsidies are given. For instance, it is given in terms of tax relief, tax rebate, letter of credit, interest-free loans, free storage facilities, lower unloading and loading charges. Then there are duty-free imports for certain products, especially for the industries situated in the special economic zone. In case of Bangladesh, they provide cheap letter of credit, then duty drawback schemes under which duties paid are returned back, then special bonded warehouse. So now, let us cover dumping. So in dumping, what does dumping imply in the international market? So in dumping, what happens, the commodity is sold at a higher price in the domestic market and the same commodity is sold at a lesser price in the international market. Now, there are various instance that why a producer goes for dumping. So there are various motives. So dumping is of three types. One is persistent, predatory and sporadic dumping. So let us look at each of them. Persistent dumping. So in persistent dumping, the commodity is sold at a higher price in the domestic market and the same commodity is sold at a lower price in the international market. Now, this is done, this sort of dumping is done because when there is less competition in the domestic market and, you know, high competition in the international market. The example can be the economy of Japan, where the electronic gadgets are sold at a higher price in the domestic market and the same electronic gadgets are sold at a lesser price in the international market. Second is predatory dumping. The predatory dumping, it has the aim of monopoly. Alright, so the seller has the aim to acquire monopoly of the product in the international market. So in predatory dumping, the seller will continue to sell his goods at a very less price than the lowest cost foreign producer, so that that foreign producer is driven out and the producer can get the monopoly. Alright, so predatory dumping, the aim is to get monopoly in the international market of a particular product. Then we have sporadic dumping. Now sporadic dumping, the aim is to protect the domestic farmers, to protect the domestic economy. Alright, now the sporadic dumping usually happens when there is unforeseen surplus. Alright, so this is basically, it takes place when there is an occasional sale of a commodity. So, for instance, if the government is registered a bumper harvest of wheat or corn, so what they will do? They will take that surplus, they will offload that surplus in the international market. Now, the aim is, if the aim is to protect the domestic farmers, because if that unforeseen surplus is offloaded in the domestic market itself, then supply will be more than the demand. So supply will be more, demand will be less, so prices will fall and the farmers, industry, traders, all of them will lose. So that excess of surplus is offloaded in the international market. So this is about dumping. So yes, I hope all of you got the concepts. So yeah, thank you.